Good morning, you both. What a beautiful, fresh and young Beethoven this was.
Thank you.
Hard work.
It is hard work, yes. It was hard work to...
Yes, sure. All 10 sonatas from Beethoven. Was this movement all a little bit away from Mozart, so to speak?
Opus 12 is the earliest we have as violin piano sonatas from Beethoven, so of course that is still coming from the Mozart tradition, and also clearly a lot of accent still on the piano part.
But already very much Beethoven when they were performed, premiered in Vienna, the critics were devastating, saying that this, nobody can understand. They think it's far too complicated. So even in Opus 12, I think one can immediately hear that's Mr. Beethoven himself.
First of all, you work already for some years together and made some beautiful recordings. What makes him a steady partner for you?
It's, as you say, it's many years now that we work together. I think it's almost 10 years. We should have a jubilee year soon. It's quite rare, or maybe impossible, to find anybody else from myself who is as inspiring over such a long period of time. And at the same time, of course, we have now such a base worked at that we have a lot of things we don't have to talk about, and we have for sure developed also during those last 10 years the same direction musically, what we are looking for.
And can you tell a little bit about this direction?
Well, I mean, for me it was very easy the first time I heard Isabel playing Bach. I constantly fell in love with her playing and with her and with the whole thing. And, it's exactly her playing was somehow, that's exactly what I wanted to hear in this music, and most of the music it's still the case. So as she says, we don't really, well, we do speak a lot, of course, but of course it saves a lot of time when stylistically you feel along the same lines, even that we're very different as musicians. But
the last 10 years have been very important for both of us, and I think it has to do a lot with this duo work that we were both also now exploring, playing on different hammer, clavier and on guard strings, as we are also recording now.
Yes.
That has of course pushed each other in the same direction and encouraged each other also.
So you did a lot of research for this project too?
Or not really research. We tried. Uh-huh. We tried to read what we can. I mean, with Beethoven, most of the research is done already. So you just need to read his diaries and his letters, and then there are tons of books.
So we also looked into the facsimiles.
We didn't discover
as much as
anything
possible, because some are not there anymore. Some are left.
So I'm prepared a little bit. What do we see here? It's a facsimile.
Yeah, this is the facsimile.
Frühling Sonata. I mean, he never called it that way, but that's the Sonata Opus 24. The funny thing about exactly this melody is that, first of all, is the first time when the violin is giving the opening theme. Then, of course, this ended up as one of the most famous Beethoven melodies, and he was probably not first and foremost melody writing type, yeah? It was a lot about motives, but not so much about beautiful melodies. This one is certainly is, what is heartbreaking is to have a look at some of his sketchbooks where you can actually see this very theme in the process of being born, you know? And then you can see how he constantly improved it, and there were 5 or 6 or even more variants, and finally you get it. And that's of course really heartbreaking, as I said, to look at it.
But that's actually quite unusual page for Beethoven, because if you look at other pieces, sonatas, but also, for example, the violin concerto facsimile, there's so much crossed out, and it's really a mess. It's difficult. You can see how difficult it was for him to finally decide. And it's very interesting, like for this melody in the sketchbooks, but also in some of the facsimiles, to see which notes he actually, in the end, change, sometimes very small changes, and it makes all the difference to us. It's quite amazing to see.
What kind of type, what kind of person he is or was?
Well, he said himself that he felt really sorry for those musicians who had to.
Yes. It was definitely a messy thing. Again, this looks actually quite clean.
Assertive.
Yeah.
It's very, very, very assertive.
Full of temperament.
Full of temperament, but very assertive, and I know what I'm talking about, and don't mess with me.
And a lot of air I see in his handwriting, really lots of directions and beautiful phrasing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Why is it so important, maybe for the two of you, but to know and to play what the composer wants?
Because it's our job.
That's what we are here for.
that's how we earn our money.
But you have your own interpretation. You have your own.
Yeah, well, I mean, this is a huge philosophical question because in different epochs, the performance. I mean, we are secondary to a composer in a massive way. We are just nothing. We are just musicians, performers. We try to serve, to bring what the composer tried to say to the audience. And of course, it always changes with the. Now maybe one doesn't need us anymore. There was all the recordings. Even. I don't know.
No, of course, in the end, it will always be our interpretation. But we feel this is our duty and our goal to come as close as somehow possible. Of course, we will never know what Beethoven actually wanted it to be played like. But as we feel that it's important for us to know as much as we can around the composer, about his personality, about his way of writing,
about
also the musicians playing his music at that time. So we are just very keen on filling up that basket as full as possible to maybe get some glimpse of his ideas.
And all this helps when you play, for example, with Franz Brueghel. You played a lot?
I did play in last October in Rotterdam, the Beethoven Violin Concerto with Franz Brueghel for the first time, and that's again changed a lot of things for me. And of course, it's also possible for me to play the Beethoven Violin Concerto not on guitar strings, but and with nowadays orchestras. Okay. But it will always give a new perspective, and I think it's important to start thinking of those works coming from what Beethoven himself knew at that time and not going backwards. I think that's what people like Franz Brueghel tried to do, and that's of course something very, very important for me.
When it's important for you to play on an older instrument or a new instrument?
Of course, if one could always play Mozart on a proper fortepiano, for me personally it would be preferable, but of course in the big halls you also need the modern piano, and I could only finally understand what the engineering marvel is, the modern piano action, only after looking and learning about all the other types of action and seeing how all the compromises are reached. And the engineeringly, it is really a miracle, the modern piano action.
Okay. And then there is, of course, we know that, for example, Brahms was not fully satisfied with so of course this evolution the instruments made had a reason also, so the modern equipment is not there by chance.
To get louder in a bigger voice. It's not only for piano, it's for every single instrument, but you gain something and you lose something also, like it's always in life.
Can I invite you to go to stage to do one other piece from Beethoven, the third movement,
yes,
on the modern Steinway,
yes,
and on your violin. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for having us.
Good luck.